Mission Audio presents Reconstructing the Gospel, Finding Freedom from Slaveholder Religion by Jonathan Wilson-Hartgrove. Narrated by Lloyd James. Foreword. The Reverend Dr. William J. Barber II. So-called white evangelicals, who say so much about what God says so little, and so little about what God says so much, have dominated public discourse about religion in America for my entire adult life. They have insisted that faith is not political, except when it comes to prayer in school, abortion, homosexuality, and property rights. They have overlooked the more than 2,500 verses in Scripture that have to do with love, justice, and care for the poor, and they have tried to make Jesus an honorary member of the NRA. What these so-called evangelicals have done is nothing short of theological malpractice. With pornographic sums of money from corporate backers, they have hijacked the gospel and used it to justify what the Bible calls sin. I'm not surprised when I meet people who tell me they're agnostic. When I was a guest on the talk show of one of America's most famous atheists, I told Bill Maher that if you're talking about a God who hates the poor, immigrants, and homosexuals, I'm an atheist too. I don't know that God, and I definitely don't believe in him. But I am an evangelical because, as my grandma used to say, I know Jesus for myself. Between my mother and father's family histories, I count more than 800 years of preaching Jesus in my lineage. In his first sermon, not his second or third, but his very first sermon, Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor." Luke chapter 4, verse 18. This is normative preaching in the Christian tradition. The good news Jesus proclaims is evangelion in the Greek, the root of our word evangelical. And it is, from the very beginning of his ministry, good news to the poor. I don't know a gospel that doesn't challenge the injustice of poverty. Biblically speaking, to be evangelical is to be concerned about the poor. The Greek word Jesus uses in Luke's gospel, tokas, refers to those who have been made poor by unjust systems. To be an evangelical is to be committed to challenging injustice and economic exploitation. It is the very opposite of the message preached by so many so-called evangelicals today. So, what happened to Christianity in America? This is the question my brother Jonathan faces head-on in this book. He follows this question to the heart of America's original sin and invites all of us to join him there and face another question. Is our God greater than America's racism? This is a question we must answer, no matter the color of our skin. Slaveholder religion has infected every corner of the church in America, including the black church. We must never forget that there were enslaved people who accepted the theology fed to them on plantations. The original sin of racism in America began with a deeply flawed and demonic notion that shaped this nation's development. Bad science claimed that black bodies were biologically deficient, then extrapolated a sick sociology that assumed that people of color had to be placed in subordinate positions. Evil economics perpetuated the lie that money and profit are the chief ends of human existence, and these ends justified almost any means. Slaveholder religion blessed all of this with a heretical ontology, asserting that God ordained racism, slavery, and systems of subjugation. The cumulative effect of this lie threatens not only the witness of Christianity in the world, but also our existence as creatures on God's good earth. Because America's self-deception is so closely tied to the incomprehensible power of weapons that can destroy the world a dozen times over, the immorality of slaveholder religion presents a very real threat to our future. As Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. saw clearly in the last years of his life, we face a real choice between chaos and community. We need a moral revolution. If that was true 50 years ago, then we must be clear today. America needs a moral revival to bring about beloved community. The main obstacle to beloved community continues to be the fear that people in power have used for generations to divide and conquer God's children who are, whatever our differences, all in the same boat. I will confess, I inherited those fears too. When I met Jonathan 20 years ago, I didn't want to work with white evangelicals in rural North Carolina. People who looked and talked like him burned a cross in my uncle's yard when I was still a boy. We don't erase the memories we each carry in our body when we come to follow Jesus. But the Jesus I know can make the children of slaves and the children of slaveholders into friends who link arms and work together for justice. This is the story of God's movement in every generation. It's also an experience I've known for myself over 2 decades of friendship with Jonathan. With a broad coalition of sisters and brothers from many backgrounds, Jonathan and I are working together to build up a poor people's campaign for moral revival, taking up the unfinished work of the Poor People's Campaign of 1967 to 1968, spearheaded by Dr. King. In view of the global challenges we all face, we cannot put off the essential work of reconstructing the gospel. God has given us good news to proclaim to the poor. May it stir us to prophetic action. Part 1. Slaveholder Religion. Chapter 1. Christmas on the Plantation. In the small southern city where I live, developers with an optimistic eye toward progress built a 21st century glass-walled theater across the street from the county jail. When I read about their plans in the newspaper, I laughed. What a lofty vision for the gravel lot where I parked my car when I drove downtown to visit my imprisoned neighbors through plexiglass. But the developers knew what they were doing. Half a decade later, the Durham Performing Arts Center, the DPAC, is ranked among the top 5 concert halls in America. Last year, Aretha Franklin sang Respect, and Disney's The Lion King danced The Circle of Life, in earshot of a high-rise where 500 people lived on lockdown 23 hours a day. I had to pay to park when I went to see a friend. Which is why, when Sammy invited me and my family to Christmas at the DPAC, I was intrigued. Having done more than his fair share of time in the high-rise with barred windows that residents ironically refer to as the White House, Sammy's not the type that usually fills one of the 2,700 seats across Magnum Street. But he is one of the first people who accepted our invitation when, some 15 years ago, my wife Leah and I moved to Durham's Walltown neighborhood and started asking neighbors to join us for dinner. Since then, we've eaten 1,000 meals with Sammy. But I still remember our first conversation when he and I realized that we were the same age, that we grew up watching the same cartoons and going through the same programs in North Carolina's public schools. Only I was white, and Sammy was black. Sammy ran the streets with guys who are locked up in the county jail. I went to grad school with people who frequent the DPAC. Christmas at the DPAC? I asked Sammy when he brought it up. How are we going to afford that? Here's what you ain't going to believe, Sammy said, his eyes wide with excitement. It's free. A local megachurch, eager to share the good news of the season, had booked the theater and invited all of Durham to celebrate together at 5 different shows. Sammy and I made a list of who would want to go and figured out how we could squeeze all 12 of us into Sammy's car and our family's minivan. We had a plan. Sammy would secure the tickets for the late afternoon show on Christmas Eve. We'd all go down together, wish our city a very Merry Christmas, then come home and eat hot dogs, Carolina style, with homemade coleslaw. Sammy was excited. He made sure the rest of us were too. After getting our kids ready, picking up Sammy's cousins, and finding a place to park, we finally made it to our seats in the balcony. The lights were down, and a drum line was finishing The Little Drummer Boy, as the scene shifted to 2 classical violinists on the other side of the stage. I balanced our youngest on my knee and watched his eyebrows rise in the glow of the stage lights as he took it all in. No wonder Sammy had been so excited. This was a serious production, highlighting great local talent in an exclusive space where, for today at least, all were welcome. It felt like we were sitting on a little bridge between two worlds, linking one side of Roxborough Road with the other. Jesus would be into this, I thought to myself. No, it wasn't peace on earth and goodwill toward all people. I knew, of course, that these balcony seats would cost $239 each when the Broadway musical Hamilton came to town, and our friends locked up across the street still wouldn't be able to make bail. But I'm a sucker for any little way we open ourselves to one another when the days grow shorter, and eventually, even the malls close their doors to honor the birth of the Savior of the world. Our evening at the DPAC wasn't a revolution, but it did feel like a little interruption, a moment to consider how, when we're willing to trust a better way, something better is possible, even here, even now. I was starting to think I could skip my reading of O. Henry's The Gift of the Magi this year, that I had my Christmas moment to hold on to, a little light to guard and keep me against winter's wind and the dark night of the soul. I was starting to feel a little bit of the affection we call the Christmas spirit. Then, the curtain dropped, the house lights came up, and a middle-aged white man walked to the edge of the stage with a Bible in his hand. Before introducing himself, this preacher hemmed and hawed about the amazing talent we'd been enjoying and what a hard act it was to follow. How he taught every now and then at the church that was sponsoring this event, and how it was his job to say a word or two about why we'd all gotten together this afternoon. The kid on my lap must have felt me tensing up. He wriggled down and crawled over to his mom. I kept hoping it wasn't true, but I sensed what was coming. Alvin, a young African-American man who'd come with us, knew it too. He stood up from his seat, climbed over a dozen people, and made a beeline for the exit. I wish I'd joined him, but I didn't. I stayed to hear about how the angels who sang when Jesus was born in Bethlehem were proclaiming the good news that Buddha and Muhammad are dead, but Jesus is alive. I listened once more to the neat little syllogism in which Jesus is the logical conclusion to a set of propositions that are assumed to be self-evident. I cringed as the earnest man who'd gone to such pains to dress himself in hipster fashion casually smiled his best smile and invited us to celebrate his message that we were all going straight to hell if we didn't align our understanding of the world with his. Alvin had seen where this was going from the start. When you live in a world that tells you your existence is a problem, you don't have patience for a religion that says the same with a smile. Soul survival demands a good BS detector for people who've been labeled black, criminal, ungodly, and undeserving. But if, like me, you've bowed your head backstage at events like this, praying that the preacher would get it right, you live in hope. Stretched between that preacher's best intentions and the way his message weighed on my friends' bodies, I started to realize I wasn't going to be able to enjoy the hot dog supper Sammy and I had been talking about all week. I looked down from my seat in the balcony and felt a little woozy. As quickly as he'd come, the preacher was gone, the curtain was up, and the multicultural choir was back again to lead us all in a rousing version of Joy to the World. I noted that the energetic young man who invited us to sing along started addressing us as church. Stand with me, church. Let me hear you put your hands together, church. Apparently, we had all been baptized by the preacher's words. Now we were church, and our worship leader was sending us out of the DPAC on a mission. We've heard some good news here this afternoon, church, and when you hear good news, you have to tell somebody about it. I want you to go out there and vomit Jesus on someone. I'd already felt like I was going to throw up. I got out of there as quickly as I could. For For several days after this experience at the DPAC, I walked around in a haze, trying to make sense of the great gap between the joy I'd felt before the preacher's message and the nausea that had followed it. I couldn't simply dismiss the whole affair. After all, he was talking about my Jesus. I am a preacher. The gospel story lives inside me and pulses to get out like fire shut up in my bones. I've heard lots of bad sermons. I've preached bad ones myself. But this one knocked the Christmas spirit right out of me. Even O. Henry's story felt flat on the page. What was bothering me, I finally realized, was that Jesus, the person I love most, had become a weapon to drive away someone I also love. Not just in some metaphorical sense. Literally. Alvin had fled the DPAC and found another ride home. The Jesus I know has been knitting our lives together for the past 15 years, but the message that sent Alvin fleeing was offered in the name of Jesus. I thought about how cerebral and distant the preacher's bridge between God and humanity felt compared to the visceral gap in my experience before and after his little talk. Not unlike the contrast between the DPAC and the county jail that I confronted again upon exiting the building, feeling every bit like I'd stepped off one of those rides at the state fair that spins you in all three directions at once. It wasn't that he'd failed to connect. No, he'd touched a nerve. In Alvin and in me, connecting with hundreds of years of history in a way that made good tidings of great joy feel like an assault. But how, I kept asking myself, had his good news come to sound so bad? Why did a message he sincerely believed to be gospel for all people send Alvin running for safety and leave me feeling like I'd betrayed my friend and myself? This was about something more than differing interpretations of the gospel. It was about the integrity of the good news itself. I had to face the breach that is real, not only in the human family and in our world, but also in the religion that was passed down to me. The gospel torn in two. A few weeks after our Christmas at the DPAC, I visited St. Matthew's Episcopal Church, a quaint chapel one town over from Durham, in Hillsboro, North Carolina. This place was never a megachurch, but 150 years ago, it was the DPAC of its day. North Carolina's elite donated the land and built this chapel in 1824. Their children intermarried, and by the end of the Civil War, a member of the church, Paul Cameron, was the wealthiest man in North Carolina. He owned most of the land that is now Durham County, and nearly 1,000 enslaved human beings. St. Matthew's priest showed a small group of us the balcony, which was added to the church mid-19th century to segregate its enslaved members from the landed gentry below. Those southern gentlemen imagined themselves as great fathers, writing often in their personal letters about our family, black and white. But they also understood the necessity of distinction. The whole plantation economy rested on every person knowing the difference between slave and free. We were standing at the front of the chapel, looking up at the balcony in the back, when a fellow visitor turned to the communion rail behind us and asked, "Were masters and slaves segregated when they came forward for communion?" "Oh, no," the priest said matter-of-factly. "They had very good sacramental theology. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all." He recalled an annual report from one of his predecessors who'd gone on to serve as Bishop of North Carolina in the mid-19th century. In it, the bishop reported on an Easter service he'd conducted in eastern North Carolina at a plantation that had its own chapel. He waxed eloquent about how preparations had been made to adorn the building and about the exceptional music that was performed. Then, he described the scene of master and slave kneeling together at the altar, receiving the body and blood of Christ. It had seemed to him a notable image of the reconciliation that Jesus Christ makes possible. But is there any record of an experience like that making someone question slavery itself? The young white woman who asked the question seemed troubled. I think she was feeling in her gut something like, what I'd felt on my way out of the DPAC a few weeks earlier. The priest paused for a long time to consider her question. He knew his parish well, the living and the dead. This was not the first time he considered the gospel's impact on their lives. "We do know that one freedman left this parish and became an abolitionist in Oberlin, Ohio. I like to think it was because of something he'd seen and heard in this church." The priest could see how desperate this woman was for a word of assurance, for some sign that the gospel has power, not simply to remind us of what should be, but to change who we are. If he'd stopped there, part of me would have been happy. One abolitionist in 1,000 is at least a glimmer of hope, even if he did have to flee this space to live out what he heard in the scriptures. But looking at our little group of visitors, all pale-skinned, the priest knew he had to tell another story, one about someone far more like most of us. Thomas Ruffin donated the land where St. Matthew's still sits today. He was an upstanding white citizen of North Carolina in the 19th century and a lifelong member of the parish, where the fellowship hall still bears his name. Ruffin was also a justice on North Carolina's Supreme Court. When a white man was convicted of assault against a woman he hired, Ruffin's court voted, in the State v. John Mann, to overturn the white man's conviction. Ruffin wrote the opinion himself. The priest had read Ruffin's words with a pastor's eye. He could see the man who was still buried in St. Matthew's graveyard wrestling in every sentence with the reality he experienced at the communion rail each Sunday. Ruffin went to great lengths to acknowledge the humanity of the slave, but legal precedent was clear. "The power of the master must be absolute," the white churchman wrote, "to render the submission of the slave perfect." Reading Ruffin's opinion, the priest said, was like watching a man tear himself in two. I thought about the two worlds that Sammy and I grew up in and the two sides of Roxborough Road, about how fractured our world is and how, deep down, each of us longs to see it made whole. I thought about how the same gospel that made some Christians want to sing praise music had sent a black person running for freedom in the 19th century and another fleeing the DPAC in the 21st century. Standing there in St. Matthew's, I had an epiphany about the gospel, the old, old story whose words I'd known since before I'd begun to grasp their meaning as a powerful force. I've seen it transform lives, lift up the brokenhearted, and spur people from bondage toward freedom. But like every good gift from God, the story of Jesus has been hijacked to serve the opposite of what God wants. The institutions of Christianity, the words of Scripture, the very message of the gospel was twisted 150 years ago to endorse what we now readily confess is sin. This was not the exception, but the rule. The one sister who heard something different at St. Matthew's had to flee north, all the way across the Ohio River, where she was still breaking federal law when she greeted formerly enslaved sisters and brothers as fellow children of God, not stolen property. Christianity in America has not occasionally turned away from the gospel's truth, like a sailor tempted by the siren's call. It has rather turned the gospel against itself, tearing in two the people who adopted this form of religion without letting its truth change their lives. This subversion of the gospel put a crack in the foundation of our common life. It opened up a great gulf between people that has thwarted our pursuit of genuine community ever since. And it has left a hidden wound deep in our hearts. Standing there in the sanctuary where Thomas Ruffin worshipped every Sunday, that great passage from the prophet Isaiah rang in my head, "And you shall be called repairer of the breach." Isaiah chapter 58, verse 12. Sometime or another, we all sense that things aren't as they should be. It's why the young white woman hoped to discover at the communion rail some link between the slave balcony and the master's pew. It's why I'd longed to experience a hint of reconciliation at a Christmas celebration where all of Durham could sit down together and sing carols without throwing up on anyone. I guess it's even what the preacher was trying to build with his bridge between God and humanity that couldn't begin to comprehend the gulf between him and Alvin. But the religious experience of a slaveholder compelled me to confess that I'd been as blind as that zealous evangelist, as naive as the young woman who'd hoped against hope that her theology trumped history. I deceived myself into thinking that the original sin that ripped this nation in two had somehow not formed me. In a chapel built by plantation owners nearly two centuries ago, a priest told me the truth. I am a man torn in two. I don't just live in a divided world, I am divided. And if it's true all the way down, not just for me, but for the sisters and brothers who've loved and taught me, then I must confess this also. The gospel I inherited is divided. I know this might not sound like good news, but I received it like a man who's been sick for a long time, dealing with symptom after symptom, finally getting a diagnosis. My soul cannot be well without the society that made it sick finding health. But that's not all. The gospel that was twisted to accommodate America's original sin must also be reconstructed if we are to experience the healing that Jesus wants to bring. Otherwise, evangelism is violence, and those of us who spend our time in church meetings are perpetuating a death-dealing culture without even realizing it. Spiritual Reconstruction. Another way of saying this is, Christians in America must come to terms with how institutional racism has infected us. Few white persons in 21st century America see themselves as racist. Even fewer Asian, Latino, or African American persons do. Most American Christians, white, black, or brown, are horrified by the idea of a Ku Klux Klan, KKK, rally, or by the public personality who occasionally gets caught saying the N-word. But personal animus against others because of the color of their skin isn't the racism that turned the gospel against itself. Remember, enslaved people were family to Paul Cameron and Thomas Ruffin. The sin that ripped the gospel into, the spiritual root of our political divisions and class disparities, is a lie that was told centuries ago to justify owning, using, and abusing other human beings. Racism is about implicit bias as much as it's about public policy. It's why a white applicant with a criminal record is as likely to get a job as an African-American with no criminal history. And it's why African-American veterans of World War II didn't benefit from the GI Bill, legislation offering educational funding, low-interest housing loans, and other support for veterans, the same way their white counterparts did. It is why, two and three generations later, the median disparity between the wealth of white and black families hasn't changed, despite the advances of the civil rights movement. Racism is why historically black neighborhoods across America are gentrifying at breakneck speed while the families who built and sustained these communities are being displaced. This is what racism means. We live in a society that continues to be divided. And we are, each and every one of us, split into ourselves. When white Christians refuse to hear cries for justice from black and brown sisters and brothers, it is one more symptom of the racism that has long divided our souls, our congregations, and our nation. When middle-class Americans silence the voices of poor black and brown people who know from daily experience that race and history still matter, our hardness of heart betrays a spiritual sickness that Jesus detected in the Pharisees of his own day. We, like them, have turned the gift of God's law against itself. Splitting the good news in two, we refashioned it as both a shield against God's grace and a sword to wield against our neighbors. We turned God's good news into our bad news. 15 years ago, Leah and I moved to Durham's Walltown community, an historically African-American neighborhood whose residents have maintained Duke University since its first janitor, George Wall, moved here in the 1890s. Ignorant of much of Walltown's history, we relocated to a place that has taught us what it means to be white. People like Sammy welcomed us into a community where we've worked and worshiped, where our kids play under the watchful eyes of grandmas who sit on their porches and young men who walk these streets, wondering whether their lives matter to anyone else. One of them knocked on the door not long ago and asked, clearly worried, if I knew my 2-year-old was playing alone on the porch. No one needs to tell this young black man that all lives matter. In this place, neighbors and friends have taught us to see racism, to name the ways history still shapes the present, and to doubt the certainties we inherited along with being white. These people, together with the Holy Spirit, have stirred up a passion within me to face America's original sin in my own heart and to join the freedom movement that is committed to exercising it from our common life. They have shown me how a gospel that doesn't confront racism is no gospel at all. In a moment of clarity, seeing myself and my gospel ripped in two by this shared history, St. Matthew's helped me to finally name what had left me feeling sick on Christmas Eve. For all my life, I've known that the gospel must reconstruct my life. Whatever humanity's problems, Jesus is the answer. This, I believe. But what do you do when you realize that your Jesus has been ripped in two, that the name of the one who came to set us free has been hijacked by the principalities and powers that bind us? What happens when, like Mary in the garden, you realize they've taken away your Jesus, and you don't know where they've laid him? It's not easy to pray in the midst of such a faith crisis. You find yourself questioning the one you used to go to with your questions, wondering if you're talking to the true and living God or some projection of your privilege that you fashioned in your own image. But a good diagnosis at least clarifies the situation. Better to see how you've been deceived, how even you've deceived yourself, than to miss the gospel because you thought you already had the answer. I call it the foggy morning of the soul, that liminal time when you can see just enough to pull the car out of your driveway, but you aren't quite sure you see where you're going. We turn our headlights on in such a situation. We sit on the edge of our seats, eyes wide open to detect whatever might emerge before us. We are afraid, yes, but we lean in, because there's no other way to get where we are going. This is why Jesus said that the poor are blessed and the hungry will be satisfied and the merciful will be shown mercy. Not because God loves them any more than he loves the rest, but because they know their need. They have a clear diagnosis. A hungry man knows he needs bread. A heart that's broken knows it wants mercy. And a soul that can see its own self-deception knows it needs good news, which is what the gospel is. A friend of mine calls it the end of your rope club. There are 1,000 ways to get there, but however we come to the end of our ropes, it is the place where we discover that our only hope is a love that comes from beyond us. Maybe you thought you've known the gospel all your life. Maybe you've always thought it sounded like some crazy con. Whatever your background, the only good news that's worth believing comes through loud and clear at the end of your rope. This is where you learn you need a Savior. After my epiphany at St. Matthew's, I went back to the texts we call the Gospels. I read again those 4 accounts of Jesus' life and death, and I saw, in a way I'd missed before, how the diagnosis of a divided faith is the beginning of the good news Jesus offered to nearly every religious person he met during his time here on earth. Jesus prayed the Psalms and quoted the Torah and spent time in the temple, but his message to religious people was surprisingly grim. Woe to you, was his constant refrain. When he took a more pastoral tone, it was usually something like, don't you remember where it is written? After reading the Bible all my life, I realized that Jesus, who was a preacher, didn't really say anything that hadn't been said before. In fact, he took pains to make clear that he was saying what the God of Israel had been saying ever since God spoke the world into existence. I have not come to abolish them, meaning the Torah and the prophets, but to fulfill them. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Jesus didn't come to preach a new gospel. Jesus came to reconstruct God's good news, which religious leaders had turned against itself. How had I missed this? How have so many sincere Christians confessed and practiced a religion that made them worse than they might have been otherwise? How, I had to ask, did slaveholder religion make a message that calls all of us out of systemic injustice and use it to subjugate generations of children created in the image of God?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.